When the researcher collects the data, one of the concerns is to describe it. We have seen earlier the descriptive statistics like central tendency or variability or the shape of the curve like kurtosis, skewness. But there is one more method which is called graphical representation of data. When we represent the data using graphs, it really becomes visual and it catches attention and the reader gets overall idea of the data which is collected by the researcher. Today we will discuss about various ways, various types of graphs which can be used for representing the distribution or the data. There are many types of graphs available like line graph, bar graph, pictogram, then frequency polygon, then scatter plots, pie chart, cumulative frequency polygon, histogram and many others. As per the needs and as per the kind of data which is collected, what you want to show to the reader, how you want to represent, the researcher can select the appropriate type of graph. The graph can be plotted for non-numeric graph, that is categories, or it can also be drawn using the numerical values. Generally, the data can be distributed in categories, but the categories, when you ask questions like what is your gender, we have seen that example earlier. So male and female are categories. In which standard are you studying? So 7th standard, 8th standard, these are the categories. There is no numerical value. Though you have the sample size, there may be 50 students from 7th grade and 80 students from 8th grade. That is not a numerical value. We are talking about the categories. So we can use the categories for representing the data. The data in terms of categories also can be represented using percentages. This is called relative frequencies. So it depends what is our purpose of presenting that. If you want to compare, if you want to show the relationship, then we can use the percentages, that is relative frequencies. Or if we are interested only in frequencies, then what is the size of the category in each category, then we can use the real frequencies. Let us take one example. If you have done a study in media use, mass media like newspaper, and you ask your sample, how often do you read newspaper? Now there are categories like every day, 3 times a week, about once a week, a few times a month, less often and never. These are 6 categories under which you will put a tick mark on the basis of the response you get from the sample. This example gives us the actual frequency for each category. For every day, 205, 3 times a week, 100 people say, about once a week, 50 people say, a few times a month, 20, less often, 10, and never 10. This is a distribution of the frequency as per the categories. Now, if you want to represent that graphically, let us see how we can do that. We can represent this data using bar graph, or it is also called as bar chart. It has bars on the x and y axis. So first of all, we have to select x and y axis. On x, it is the categories, and on y axis, that is vertical axis, there is a frequency. Now you can use Excel or you can plot it manually, but it will look like this. In this, you have 6 categories, and in each category, the frequency is shown. This is shown vertically, but you also can show it horizontally. You can use Excel software for it, and then you can convert that horizontal to vertical. This also shows you the same thing, the categories and the frequency. Immediately it is clear that the maximum number of people read the newspaper every day. We also saw that instead of using frequency, we can use relative frequencies, that is percentage. This graph gives you a representation of your distribution using percentages or relative frequency. Bar graph also can be used for showing the comparison or relationship, not correlationship, but it is whether high or low or changes in 2 or 3 different categories. For example, you have census survey done in 2001 and 2011. You want to compare the literacy rate. Now, it can be shown together in, say, for example, adult literacy rate in age of 15 to 35 or 35 to 45. You can have categories, and for that, in 2001 and 2011, you can have bars side by side. This graph shows you that. This graphical representation enables you to compare the changes from 2001 to 2011. There are certain rules which we must follow while using bar graph or bar chart. You have seen it is a bar, it looks like a bar. And now you have also seen that its width is same. That means area covered is shown as with the same width. The bars are at equal distance from each other. We will later on see the histogram where the bars touch each other. Here you will see in bar graph, bars do not touch each other. They are distance which is equidistant from each other. If your data is non-numerical data, then actually there is no sequence. Say if you are talking about gender, male or female, which one should come first and which one should come later. So, you can arrange it any way you like. Take the same example now. How often do you read newspapers? So, these are the categories. If you arrange it in a sequence as by using some kind of a condition, then this chart will be known as Pareto chart. For drawing a bar graph, as I said earlier, you should have x-axis and you should have y-axis. They are perpendicular to each other. Now, the cross section of x and y axis is shown as 0, 0. That means they are starting at 0. But they can start at 10, they can start at 100, depends. Generally, we start origin at 0. Now, from 0, from left to right and from 0 to upward on y axis, you take frequency. Another characteristic of this bar chart is the length or the height of the bar chart. This height represents the frequency or the number of people in that category. It is proportional to that. So, when we draw a bar graph or a bar chart, on the top of it we can write the frequency or we also can write the percentage. If you are taking the relative frequency, you can put that frequency there. So, instead of counting it on the y-axis, the reader can directly see it on the bar itself. We must remember that x and y axis are titled. When you show the x axis, there is an arrow there. That means it's a line. Line is always represented with an arrow. Now, on x axis, you may or you may not state the categories because the categories can be given as a legend on the right hand side. But on frequency side, we must write the frequency or the relative frequency so that it is clear for the reader. Because the bar is shown at a certain height, and as we have already seen, this height is proportional to the frequency. Bar chart or bar graph can also be used for numerical data. The same rules apply when we use the numerical data. We have drawn this bar graph for category. That means we asked, how often do you read the newspaper? So, that often creates certain categories. So, there were six categories showing you the oftenness. So, it becomes categorical data. It was not a numerical data because though you have the numbers, for each category you had some number. That doesn't mean this is a numerical data, still it is a categorical data. But if you ask a question, how many days in a month or in a week? Suppose we ask them, how many days in a week do you read the newspaper? So, here it is not a category, it's a days, and days are counted. It's a continuous data. So, it is a numerical data, it's not a category. So, you have to understand the differences in categorical as well as numerical data. Of course, you can use bar graph or bar chart to represent both types of data. Now, we will see another type of graph which is called histogram. If you see this diagram, you will see the difference immediately. What do you see? What is a striking feature? There are bars, yes, but all the bars are next to each other. They have touched each other. Like a bar graph, it also gives you the frequency of a distribution. Every bar shows you the frequency of your distribution, but they are connected. They are touching each other. and that is why they are covering certain area of your distribution. So total frequency can be also calculated from the histogram. So you can see here they are not discrete data, it's a continuity. There is a continuity because that is shown in a representation of histogram. This word histogram was coined by Carl Pearson. Now let us see how to draw a histogram. You have seen that there are bars, but you also see that the bars are created or drawn on a specific point. And this point is called a midpoint of a class interval. That implies that you should have a class interval first. If you have a data scores, which are called ungrouped data, this ungrouped data has to be grouped first. And how do we group them? We have class intervals. Class interval, it is an interval. So it has a starting point, it has an ending point. For example, 10 to 20. Instead of 20, we can take 10 to 19. Another class interval will start from 20 to 29. Third will start from 30 to 39. These are called class intervals. And for each class interval, you will have certain frequency. For example, if you are talking about 50 students in your class, you have given them a test of anxiety. So there is a certain score. And this score ranges from 40 to 110. Now you can have class intervals starting from 40 and ending at 110. You decide what should be the length of the class interval, because the range is 70, and if you want about 7 or 8 class intervals, you can certainly keep 10 as your class interval size. So you can have 40 to 49, 50 to 59, and like this you can have 7 or 8 class intervals, and you can put their frequency in front of that. So this is called a distribution table. This table has class intervals and frequencies. Now if you want to plot histogram, then you must also have a midpoint of the class interval. How to find out the midpoint? It is a middle point. So if your class interval starts at 40 and ends at 49, what is the lower limit? It is about 0.5 less, that means 39.5. And what is the upper limit? It is 49.5. So in order to find out the midpoint, you add these two and divide it by 2. So you will get a midpoint. For all class intervals, you will have midpoints. Now you will use midpoints for creating or drawing histogram. You will see that size of class interval is same, 10. That means the width of the bar also will be equal. It will be 10. Because midpoint of first class interval will be say 45. Next it will be 55, next it will be 65. So on your x-axis you will have 45, 55, 65, 75, 85 and so on. So when you are plotting a graph, that bar will be on both sides of the midpoint, which will also cover the lowest level and of the upper level of the class interval. Now you have x-axis and you have y-axis. On x-axis you have midpoints of your class interval, and on y-axis you will have frequencies. So midpoint and frequency, you can plot points. You have bars. And how do we have the bars? Because the size of the length of the class interval is taken for every bar. So that is the width of the bar. So every bar will touch each other, because the lower point of one is upper point of another. How many class intervals you should have? What should be the width? It depends on the researcher. You should see that instead of 7, if you have 17, nobody is going to ask you why did you have 17. But you must see visually how would it look like. If you have only 3 class intervals, how would it look like? So ultimately, it is a decision taken by the researcher. There is no hard and fast rule, but you have to decide. It should look visually sound. Because it's a graph, it is a visual representation. So what counts is visual representation. It should look good to your eyes. Let us see one example of distribution of the data, which is grouped together using class intervals. The class interval starts from 0 and ends at 699. So 0 to 99 frequency is 35, 100 to 199 frequency is 63, 200 to 299 frequency is 70, 300 to 399 frequency is 85, 400 to 499 frequency is 75, 500 to 599 frequency is 45, and 600 to 699 frequency is 25. This is a distribution given. We want to draw a histogram. You will see this example, how a histogram looks like. you will see that every bar is standing on the midpoint and the upper limit is shown as its frequency. You will see here that histogram shows you the shape of the distribution. We have also seen the skewness and kurtosis. There also we can have histograms, and histogram will give you an idea whether distribution is too peaked one or it is skewed one. The histogram also shows you the center of distribution. Generally, if it is near to normal, you will see the middle point of the distribution will have the maximum frequency. But of course, the distribution also can be bimodal. There can be two points where you have similar higher level of frequency. It also shows you the spread, how it is spread, how the distribution is spread, how the scores are spread can be seen immediately by seeing the histogram. We have seen histogram and we have also seen bar graph or bar chart. We have seen that they are nearly same but not exactly same, because we have seen the bar graphs show the bars which are not touching each other, they are separate. So they don't show you the total area covered. Whereas histogram, the bars are touching each other, that means they are showing you the total area covered of the distribution in terms of frequency.